It's now my pleasure to begin our program by introducing our moderator, Karen Polzine. Karen is a 1977 graduate of Concordia College who majored in accounting and English. As your program notes, Karen enjoyed a very successful 33-year career at Cargill, where she held many high-level leadership roles within the controller's organization. Karen has described parallels between her Concordia experience, including a collegial family-like atmosphere and a bedrock commitment to ethics and values. In retirement, she has continued her lifelong personal commitment to service in the community as an active member of St. Stephen Lutheran Church, board member at the Plymouth Christian Youth Center in North Minneapolis, and store to door in Roseville, and as a mentor for students in the Offutt School of Business. Karen was honored with Concordia's highest alumni achievement award in 2013. Are you seeing a trend here? We're so thankful to have Karen moderating today. Please join me in welcoming her. Karen Polzine.
Thank you, Dr. Duran. It's my honor this morning to introduce Christy. Kristen Morse leads the Margaret A. Cargill Philanthropies, which is composed of three grant-making organizations formed by the late Margaret A. Cargill: Akaloa, Resource Foundation, the Anne Ray Charitable Trust, and the Margaret A. Cargill Foundation. Christy has served as board chair and chief executive officer of each organization since 2006. The Philanthropies carry on Ms. Cargill's legacy by supporting activities about which she cared passionately, including the environment, aging services, disaster relief, the arts, children and families, and animal welfare. Where appropriate, the Philanthropies focus on low attention or overlooked causes. In 2015, the three entities had combined assets nearing $7.1 billion and awarded more than 180 grants, totaling $245 million. Grants may be at the local, national, or global scale, but the overarching grant strategy is to support sustainable solutions at the community level by partnering with capable organizations with a proven track record. Christy leads each board in developing organizational strategies, evaluating funding priorities, and assessing program effectiveness. A hallmark of Christy's leadership is building highly collaborative relationships with partners and grantees. Christy brings 30 years of business experience to the Philanthropies, with particular expertise in investment strategy and management. She held various accounting and credit management positions at Cargill Inc., where she was recruited as a management trainee upon graduation from Gustavus Adolphus College. At Cargill, she began her career in internal audit, moving to a staff position reporting to the president of one of the company's largest divisions. She took a leave from Cargill to become the first visiting professor to fill the endowed Charles Jordan Chair in Accounting and Management at Gustavus Adolphus College, where she taught courses in accounting, finance, economics, and management. She then returned to Cargill as a vice president and controller of Waycross Inc., a financial advisory firm for family owners of Cargill. At Waycross, Christy worked with high net worth individuals, including Ms. Cargill, on a wide range of financial services ranging from taxes to investments and insurance. The business relationship between Christy and Ms. Cargill became an endearing 15-year friendship. Christy was instrumental in helping Ms. Cargill realize her philanthropic goals of her financial and estate planning, and Ms. Cargill personally designated Christy to lead the three philanthropies. Christy holds a BA in accounting with a minor in psychology from Gustavus Adolphus College, where she served as on the Business Advisory Council and the Board of Trustees. In 2016, the college will honor Christy with the Distinguished Alumni Citation, which Kathy referred to earlier. Christy and I met the summer of 1977 when we both started at Cargill as those management trainees, and we've been friends ever since. Together with six other women from Cargill, we formed a dinner club, which has spanned 37 years of friendship. We've celebrated weddings, births, significant birthdays, and career successes. We've also supported and cared for each other when we've had disappointments, life and career challenges, and losses of parents and siblings. Even with all of her professional success, Christy's someone who's always there for others. She's part of my village, and I'm honored to have her called be one of my best friends. Please join me in welcoming Christy Morse.
Wow, thank you, Karen. Well, good morning. It is a real honor to be here today, and particularly as the first nonprofit CEO to speak to the Offutt School Presents group. As the title of my presentation says, I'm here today to tell you the story of two women, Margaret Cargill and me, and how our paths brought us in direct and not so direct ways into the world of philanthropy. Before I tell our story, I want to mention that many, many people, and women in particular, played crucial roles in this story. But in the end, the simple story is that it took Margaret Cargill to envision the organizations that combine to stand among the 10 largest philanthropies in the United States, and it was up to me to help that vision take shape and become a reality. So let me start with some history. I'm going to have slides so you can peek at those, and they will give you some idea of the people that I'm referring to and talking about. Margaret Ann Cargill was born in 1920, the granddaughter of William Wallace Cargill, which made her an heiress to the Cargill family wealth. When she died in 2006, she was the company's largest individual shareholder, owning about 17% of the outstanding stock. Margaret grew up in Minnesota. Her father, Austin Cargill, and later her brother, Jim, were senior executives of Cargill Incorporated. While she grew up in comfort, her parents instilled in her a strong work ethic and traditional Midwestern values, and she embraced those into adulthood. Margaret herself never was directly involved in the company. Her interests were in the arts and the outdoors. She earned a degree in art education from the University of Minnesota in 1954. And as a young woman, she loved to travel. Much of her travel revolved around her interest in arts and crafts, particularly Native American and folk art, fiber arts, weaving, and jewelry making. In the mid-1950s, Margaret moved to Southern California, where her parents had retired. She lived the rest of her life in La Jolla. Her lifestyle was quiet and unassuming, and many of her closest friends were unaware of her connection to Cargill. They certainly did not know that she was an heiress. My own path to philanthropy began with a long career in business. My father owned a company that manufactured agricultural equipment, and starting as a teenager, I did the accounting. When my father died, my mother and I ran the company until we could sell it. Then I finished college at Gustavus Adolphus College, you know, in St. Peter. With an accounting degree from Gustavus and a deep understanding of the agricultural industry, I was recruited by Cargill, as Karen said, in 1977 when she and I both started as management trainees. In fact, we were part of probably the first trainee group with a significant number of women. Working for a complex global company was a wonderful experience, and it turned out to be excellent training for what has lay ahead of me. I took a leave from Cargill in 1990-91 to become, as Karen mentioned, the first visiting professor for the C. Charles Jackson Chair in Finance and Accounting. When it was time to return to Cargill, I was offered the opportunity to be vice president and controller at Waycross, the family office for the Cargills and the McMillans, the owners of Cargill Inc. A family office does provide a wide variety of services to family members, from financial advice and estate planning to finding and working with their expert tax and legal providers. Working in the family office was interesting, and during my time there, I became a certified financial planner and made good use of my certified credit executive designation. At Waycross, I was assigned to work with several Cargill family members, including Margaret. Our relationship started out as strictly business. We began corresponding in 1991, and we met face-to-face in 1993. Over time, our interactions expanded from business only to include what was a deeply personal relationship and a friendship built on trust. We discovered that we had a lot in common, despite our age difference. One instant and important connection was our Minnesota roots. Another was that we were both women. She appreciated the opportunity to work with a businesswoman. Women of her generation were not involved in business, and in fact, they were often at a disadvantage because financial information was not routinely shared with them. She trusted me to help her with things that were deeply personal to her, from managing the remodel of her home, to finding her a Swedish chef, to shopping for cars and RVs, which I know very little about. I also managed her financial affairs and things such as her interest in taxes and eventually her health care. As her focus turned to philanthropy, I helped her with that as well. Margaret's other trusted advisor was Kathy Hopper, a retired assistant superintendent of San Diego's public school system. Kathy and Margaret had been friends for over 30 years, and over time, Kathy and I developed a very strong bond as well. Perhaps the most important connection among the three of us was learning that we had deeply held and shared values. Together, Kathy and I helped Margaret understand the magnitude of her wealth and the impact it could have, how she could make a lasting difference in her own community and beyond that. She asked Kathy and me to help her do just that. I want to stress that Margaret felt her wealth was not something that she had personally earned. I spent a lot of time reviewing her finances with her, and she appreciated that her father had worked hard to build the Cargill business and create that wealth. She viewed it as a great gift. Another important point is that Margaret understood that as Cargill family members, her other relatives did not need her financial generosity. They were already heirs to the same Cargill wealth. So she decided to make philanthropy the focus of her estate planning. She became interested in supporting organizations that contributed to her quality of life in Southern California. In the early 1990s, she gave generously to organizations that were important to her, primarily in the San Diego area. At the same time, she wanted to give anonymously, which was difficult to do in a tight-knit community like San Diego. That desire for anonymity, while at the same time increasing her giving, led to the creation of our formal philanthropic organizations. The role Kathy and I played was largely twofold. First, we encouraged Margaret to articulate her philanthropic goals. What issues were important to her and which were not? What organizations or types of organizations did she want to support? And likewise, which did she not want to fund? There were certain places or groups of people that were important to her, and what were they? Second, we made sure that Margaret had legal and financial resources she needed to fully explore the options available to her and then bring to life what she wanted to do. In 1995, she created the Akaloa Resource Foundation. The name satisfied her need for anonymity, and it held personal significance for her. Akaloa was thought to mean wind through the pines, which was a nice connection to her own personal love of nature. Akaloa is a supporting organization, which means it is allowed to fund only nonprofits that are named in its formation documents. In this case, those organizations were chosen by Margaret. The supporting organization structure aligns with the values that Margaret articulated. She preferred an approach to giving that relied on close, deep relationships with organizations working on issues she cared about. A supporting organization is required to maintain strong, ongoing relationships with its designated beneficiaries. The beneficiaries Margaret chose for Akaloa were the organizations she knew and respected for the work they did on issues that she cared about. With the organizations she wished to support identified, Akaloa began grant-making slowly. The first board consisted of Margaret, her attorney, me, and Kathy. We knew we had a lot to learn about philanthropy before we rushed in, and so we started our due diligence by getting to know the organization listed in the Akaloa formation documents, getting to know them one by one. To know these organizations also helped us better understand Margaret's charitable interests and her giving philosophy, which we would later document into her guiding principles. Some of these principles included a desire to help others help themselves, to be willing to fund low attention and underserved areas, to work more at an individual and community level rather than a policy level, and to consider innovative approaches, including the use of technology. Her principles continue to shape our grant making to this day. In 1996, Margaret created a second philanthropy, the Ann Ray Charitable Trust, named after her mother, Ann Ray Cargill. Unlike Akaloa, this foundation was specifically structured to accept assets from Margaret's trust. Ann Ray was also a supporting organization with a list of designated beneficiaries similar to Akaloa. These named beneficiaries were selected for their ability to work in program areas of interest, although with a broader and in some cases global focus. I want to mention that one Ann Ray beneficiary in particular, since it's close to home here in the Twin Cities. Margaret previously had made anonymous gifts to the American Swedish Institute in Minneapolis, and she decided to continue that support through the Ann Ray Charitable Trust. Over time, Akaloa and Ann Ray slowly ramped up grant making as Margaret continued to contribute assets to those organizations. As our grant making grew, we felt it was important to have an impartial third party document Margaret's intent. I had the perfect candidates, Paul Bush and Naomi Horsager, both at Arthur Andersen, which was then a major accounting firm here with a large presence in the Twin Cities. And the two of them had some knowledge of Margaret as they had been handling her taxes very discreetly for several years. Paul and Naomi, who are here today, sitting at our table, asked and sat with Margaret and asked her good clarifying questions and documented her wishes carefully. With a focus on what drove those interests, she revealed what she wanted to support, what she did not want to support, and laid out her preferences to fund under-recognized topics and underserved populations. As Margaret's estate planning continued, we recognized that the supporting organization structure didn't easily allow for the unforeseen. What if a designated beneficiary went out of existence? Or what if it merged with another organization? Or if it changed its mission into something that she didn't want to support? At the same time, Kathy and I were urging Margaret to allow her name to be used. She adamantly refused, arguing that the recognition should go to the organizations that were doing the good work on the ground and not to her as a donor. We respected her desire to be anonymous during her lifetime, but we also felt strongly that her incredible kindness and her generosity deserved recognition. Eventually, she agreed to create a traditional private foundation to be called the Margaret A. Cargill Foundation. This foundation would have much more flexibility to choose grantees based on her interests, but the foundation would only come into being at her death. Margaret did not assign priorities to her interests, leaving it up to the future leaders of those of our organizations to do so. But she did lay out a common mission and guiding principles. She saw the separate foundations as part of one philanthropy, a philanthropy we now call the Margaret A. Cargill Philanthropies. Margaret passed away on August 1st, 2006, at the age of 85. She died in the comfort of her home in La Jolla, surrounded by people she loved and who loved her. A year later, Kathy also passed away. Her death left me in the sad and unwelcome position of being the last of the three original planners to be. And to be honest, it was a very difficult time since my personal and professional inner circle had essentially disappeared. Because of my close friendship with Margaret and my deep understanding of what she hoped her wealth could achieve, I often felt very much on my own to bring those philanthropies to life. Prior to Kathy's death, she and I had identified Paul Bush as her successor. Paul joined the Akaloa board in 2005 and became a trustee of the Anne Ray Charitable Trust and the Margaret A. Cargill Foundation in 2006. He was named Chief Operating Officer of the combined philanthropies in 2008 and then president in 2011. It took 5 years to settle Margaret's estate. One of the big challenges that Paul and I faced was to find a path to liquidity, a way to turn her Cargill shares into cash for grant making. On May 25th, 2011, after several years of negotiation and planning, we entered into a transaction with Cargill. Our stock was exchanged for some of Cargill's shares in the publicly held Mosaic Company. The transaction was designed to benefit all Cargill shareholders. For us, it provided liquidity and freed Margaret's shares for the benefit of the charitable organizations we supported. What the 2011 transaction meant was that we finally could focus shift all our energies into grant making. The Margaret A. Cargill Foundation developed strategies after carefully reviewing and thinking about what Margaret wanted us to support. Even with a large asset base, it isn't large enough to solve every problem everywhere in the world. We generally developed an overall program strategy before we hired a program director, and that is because the strategy we chose at that time directed the kind of experience and expertise we wanted in a program director. The Margaret A. Cargill Foundation's Environment Program was the first grant-making area to be developed. Our early grants, made shortly after that transaction, were to nonprofits working in the Great Bear and Tongass region of Western Canada and Southern Alaska, and also to the Micronesia Conservation Trust. By the end of 2011, trustees also approved a grant to support a major new initiative in community-based conservation of coral reefs and fisheries in Indonesia. Indonesia is the most biodiverse marine area in the world, as well as a major population center where fisheries are vital to their daily life. Within our environment efforts, we recently launched a college sustainability effort which promotes environmental education. In fact, Concordia College was one of our first grantees. The funding for the expanded environmental coursework and sustainability-focused internships. The environmental area was followed quickly by our disaster relief work, with grants that we gave to flooded areas in North Dakota and tornadoes that had hit Minnesota, Missouri, Arkansas, Oklahoma, and Alabama in 2011. These grants are examples of the guidance that Margaret gave us to fund low-attention areas. Our research showed that natural disasters on the East Coast and the West Coast received significantly more media attention and charitable dollars than those disasters that occur in the Midwest. That's why our disaster grant making in the U.S. focuses on our nation's midsection. Our third program to launch was Arts and Cultures. And that began supporting Native arts and cultures and initiatives in the Pacific Northwest in 2012. We've also expanded our funding into areas such as folk arts and art education. Since then, these three programs continue to build their grant-making portfolios. We have also launched aging services and animal welfare grant-making in the U.S. Globally, we have funded learning grants in areas ranging from vaccination programs to neglected tropical diseases to maternal and child health. As the Margaret A. Cargill Foundation began this early grant-making, additional liquidity also allowed the ANRAE Charitable Trust to significantly ramp up its grant-making. While our grant-making started small, it grew rapidly and exponentially, particularly in recent years as we've achieved full liquidity. I will give you an idea of what that looks like in financial terms. In 2008, we made just over $12 million in grants. In 2012, that number grew to more than $71 million in grants. And in 2015, across our three entities, our grant making was just shy of $257 million. Those early years have obviously grown dramatically, but what makes a particular impact on me is when I look at the growth in grant making over time. Those very first Akaloa grants were made in 1995. As we celebrated our 20 years of grant making in December of 2015, the Margaret A. Cargill Philanthropies together had made more than $1 billion in grants. That's a milestone. To support activities, thank you. I must admit, we had a little celebration internally. And I signed the $1 billion check. It was great. To support activities that surround this level of grant making, MACP, as we call our Margaret A. Cargill Philanthropies, our staff has grown from one that could sit around a single table to a team of almost 90 people. Because we are relatively young philanthropy, I think we have a distinct advantage in that we still have a very close connection to our founder and her vision. But there are also approaches to our work that we think make us unique and different from many other philanthropies. One differentiator is obvious. We have three legally separate grant-making entities, but we operate with a common mission, common values, and a shared philosophy of grant-making. How we go about doing so is different by necessity. ANRAE and Akaloa approach grant-making through the lens of named beneficiaries, while the Margaret A. Cargill Foundation does approach its work through program strategy. There are a few other things that I think set us apart. We are stewards of our founder's values, style, and vision. As I mentioned, we feel fortunate to have this type of guidance from Margaret, and it is truly the heart of how we operate. We have spent a lot of time clarifying our organizational values in a manner that applies to how we work and how we do our work every day. We have identified six cultural values that define us as an organization. And you can see them on the screen: making a difference, excellence, integrity, respect, learning, and humility. If you look at our definitions and our examples, you will see that they are actions we expect our employees to demonstrate externally with our grantees and internally with each other. I will mention learning specifically because it is so integral to our DNA. From our early due diligence to our many learning grants to our commitment to incorporating evaluation into our grant making. And I'll also mention humility, and that is unique not just as a cultural value, but in how we define it. It is deliberately in quotation marks, because they are words Margaret used all the time. "It's not about me, it's not about us," she would say to me. "I just write the checks. It's the good work that people are doing that should get the attention." These values are incorporated into everything we do, from interviewing and onboarding to strategic planning and program evaluation. We look to our key partners and grantees, and they help us shape what we do. We build program strategies. We ask how a given approach addresses our core values and the difference that we can make in the world, and that Margaret intended us to make. And we evaluate potential grantees. How they do their work is important, especially how it reflects respect for their partners and the people in the communities where they operate. None of these factors alone necessarily make us unique, but we think the combination of these factors truly does make us a different type of philanthropy. So here we are. We started with one woman's giving within her community, grew that into two formal foundations. We built a third foundation after her death and have come together as one philanthropic organization. Margaret's financial legacy has given us avenues to achieve things that she only could have dreamed. For me, I look back to my early 20s, which is a long time back now, doing the books for my family business at my father's factory, and I could never have imagined the path that my career would take, this path. I certainly would not have predicted that a client relationship could turn into such a deep and life-altering friendship. Nor could I have predicted that philanthropy would become the focus of my career and indeed my life. Pardon me. Margaret is in my heart, and she's on my mind constantly as I work. I believe that one of my obligations is to instill her wishes and her values into the Margaret A. Cargill Philanthropies and do this in perpetuity, just as we invest our assets to allow us to make grants into perpetuity. If I succeed, and I must say I am determined to do so, if I instill those wishes, that will be my mark as a philanthropist. Thank you.
Think of your questions, and if some of you have them, maybe raise your hands. We have some roving mics so that they can come to you, but I'll start with my questions first.
All right.
So you talked about you accept proposals by invitation only. So how do you identify your grantees, and how do you have confidence that you haven't missed a good organization?
Right. And that's a challenge, I must say. But we go about it in a couple of ways. One is that when we look at an interest area and we do our due diligence, we take an extended period of time to do that. We gather group of experts in the sector, both from other foundations, from academia, from nonprofit sector, and we gather those people together. We have in the past employed a consulting group to do a gap analysis of the area we want to be effective in. And then we show that paper to these experts and ask for their feedback and say to them, what did we miss? How can we do this better? And then we take their input and reflect back on our mission and say, how can we play this out in the world? So it takes us a considerable amount of time, and all those people have knowledge of nonprofits and NGOs that are working in the area that we may or may not know. Another major thing that we do, and you will see by the picture of our employees and my employees that are here today, we hire really good people, and they're really smart, and many of them have a lot of experience in what their sector of knowledge on the ground, either domestically or around the world when they come to us. So they know the kinds of organizations that can do the work that we want to do. So that gives you an idea.
Great.
Yeah.
So you spent many years in business before going into philanthropy. Do you think that helped or hindered you in knowing what to do in philanthropy? And in hindsight, Do you wish that you had had any special training or education to prepare you for this?
I think it was a really, really good background, frankly, to go into philanthropy, because as I have learned ramping up from three of us, we're non-paid, to 90 people that we pay, that you really have to run a philanthropy in many ways as a business. So you've got to meet payroll, you've got to handle your assets and invest them wisely, you have to meet your tax regulations and various and sundry, many regulations, IRS regs, and all that. And so I think that the business training really did help. I think probably for me, the major, enlightening thing is coming from business where your value is in what you develop individually as a company and what the proprietary information you have. Coming into philanthropy was a change, because in philanthropy, we are about collaborating and sharing with our peers. So if we know how to do something well, we invite and we talk with our peers and our colleagues in other foundations about how to do it and collaborate and share. I think probably the best example of that was my shock and amazement when I went to see, when we first started, after Margaret passed away and we could tell people who we were. We hadn't told anyone before that who we were, so it was a big step. But when I went out and visited with a major foundation on the West Coast, and the president handed me their board book and said, you know, I've taken out some names, but this will give you an idea how we do what we do. And that's not something you do in business, right? And it was great, because it gave me a format to say, okay, this fits us, this doesn't. It was very, very helpful.
Great. All right, do we have any questions yet from our audience? And we also invite questions from the group in Moorhead that are listening. Questions at this point? Hang on one second and we'll get you a mic.
Strangely enough, maybe I missed it, but I didn't get a huge sense of her connection back to Minnesota, except perhaps for the establishment of the foundation.
She grew up in Minneapolis.
Yeah, and I didn't get a strong sense of any philanthropical feelings about coming back to Minnetonka or where the wealth was created or whatever. Did I miss it, or is there something?
Well, kind of missed it, but okay. So one of our designated beneficiaries is the American Swedish Institute here in town. But we have what we call a legacy and opportunity program, which is focused on grant making in our area, so that we are good citizens of our area. She was interested in Minnesota. Historically, she grew up here. She lived in the Twin Cities. She enjoyed camps in northern Minnesota, which is where her love of the environment was nurtured. She did move out to California early on in 1957, fairly early in her life. But she always had a very warm spot for what was going on here. And so through our initiative fund, not a program, we do not have a Minnesota program, but Minnesota is part of our disaster relief domestic program. It is part of our arts and culture for Native American and Scandinavian. Wisconsin is prominent in our teacher, our art education and teacher work that we do. And so we think it's important. We don't single it out as a program in and of itself. So we try to be supporters in a variety of ways in the way we think she would want to be.
Great. Other questions? Right here.
So what's the biggest challenge that you face in grant making today that you didn't or couldn't have anticipated 10 years ago? Oh, and my. What do you think will be the biggest challenge in 5 years?
Oh my, okay. I should have figured that was gonna come up, right? probably the biggest challenge that I think I didn't quite have a grasp on, and I think it's probably still gonna be one of our big challenges going forward, is that our philosophy of grant making is in community, which you heard me say, rather than policy. And so that means that it's important for us to collaborate with other foundations that are doing policy work, because policy work creates the enabling conditions that allow you to get the job done, right? And so I think part of it is keeping that focus true to what Margaret wanted us to do and work with the people rather than the policy. That is always a challenge. I think, too, it's a challenge because we hope to continue to keep our staff lean. And in order to do that, you have to work with those key partners who you can give a large grant to and believe in and trust and follow up to know that they're doing the right thing with it on the ground, whether it's here or in Indonesia or in Africa or in South America or in Arkansas. Missouri. And so I think part of it is going to be making sure we have a high quality and lean staff rather than letting it balloon. It's always easy to say, I needed one more person to do this and this and this, rather than to say, am I doing it the most efficiently? And am I working with the right partners? So I think both of those are, I think that's true both in the past and in the future. The other one that I maybe didn't understand so much 10 years ago was how really important it is to have good people. And not just good people, but people who understand our value system and understand our mission and take it to heart. Because what I tell our employees is that they are our face in the world. When they go to a community in Iowa or Montana or halfway around the world, they are what people see as the Margaret A. Cargill Philanthropies, and that's a huge responsibility. And so having really good people is incredibly important.
All right, are there any questions from Moorhead? Ellie?
Yep, I have a question from the students. Could you elaborate on the diversity and expertise and the diversity and background for the workforce at MACP?
Sure. We have we have a really interesting group of people. When we started out, we were told, oh, it's going to be hard to get anyone to move to Minnesota. You know, it's cold and it's barren and all this stuff. And we're going, I don't think so. And we have employees. We have a fellow from China on our staff. We have two people from New Zealand. We have people to go to the diversity. We have people, languages spoken within our group are things like the Native American Dakota, Vietnamese, Portuguese, Swedish, and then some of the standards, German and, you know, that kind of thing. But languages that are helpful to them as they work in communities around the world, as they do their program work. And we strive for diversity. You know, the organizations began with three women, and so for us, diversity was bringing in men. and we've done that fairly successfully. And Paul is a good example. He was the first one and a good hire. So, but we do keep it in mind, absolutely.
All right. One more question, because we're running out of time. And how about right here?
Sorry, long-winded answers.
Huh? I'm curious, when you look at the charities that you support, how big a factor do you look at how much of the money actually gets to the ground, as you said earlier?
Mm-hmm. It's really important. We do understand, and if you follow philanthropy, you will know that there's a big discussion going on in our community now and within NGOs about foundations that support only programs. In other words, only the work that goes, that they want to be done on the ground. And that has, in some people's minds, created a hollowing out of the core, of the core of the organizations. Because we work with key partners and designated beneficiaries, we also, and we're interested in underfunded and low attention things, we also support their core operations. So we know that if we're going to give money to a large global organization, if it doesn't have a good financial system, how can I expect good reporting if they can't keep track of the money, right? So there are some things that we do to support their core, and some people would call some of that as overhead. Some of it is actual operational work that they need to do. But we do limit our, we do limit the amount of overhead we put into our grants. But we also do those grants for, we may do a capital grant to build a building that they sorely need on a college campus or something like that. So it, but to answer your question, it's important.
Okay. I think we want to honor everyone's time this morning.
Yeah.
And so let's give a great round of applause for Christy and the work she's doing.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. On behalf of Concordia College and the Offutt School of Business, let me again express our thanks to Christine Morse and Karen Paulzine for joining us today for a great conversation. And I think as I listened to you, and we had an event at the Margaret A. Cargill Philanthropies last night, there is a very strong value at Concordia that has the acronym BREW. Happens to be my name, so it's near and dear to me. And it stands for Becoming Responsibly Engaged in the World. And what I saw last night and this morning is the epitome of that, which may explain why there were so many cobbers on the panel last night, because McPhee is an organization that attracts Concordia graduates because of that value system. So it's something that was absolutely clear to us who were there last night, and I think to all of you, how strong the culture and the organizational values are at McPhee and how important that is to its success. So thank you again. Many people have helped us in making this event possible, but we'd like to especially thank our corporate partners who've supported us today. Bell State Bank and Trust, Boulay Accounting, Fontis Investments, the Margaret A. Cargill Philanthropies, Michael Commercial Real Estate, RDO Equipment and RDO Integrated Controls, U.S. Bank, and table sponsors Lindquist and Venom and Norway House. If you have suggestions for future speakers or are interested in learning more about ways to engage our students, which we'd be happy to help with, as mentors or with internships, please see any of our staff after our program, anybody with one of these name tags on. If you'd like to be on our mailing list for future events, please feel free to leave your business card in the bowl on the registration table as you leave. Finally, we invite you to join us for the next edition of the Offutt School Presents. As I mentioned earlier, this fall on November 3rd, right here at Windows on Minnesota, our presenter will be technology entrepreneur Phil Soren, executive chairman of VidCoo. We look forward to seeing you for what we know will be a great conversation. Thanks for coming and have a great day.